regular folk that are here all the time or whether you are a visitor, it does not matter. We're just so glad that you're here. We hope that you'll find a welcome place. I've got a couple of announcements, and then Frank and Haley have an announcement, and Velvet has an announcement, so I'm going to hurry through this. You'll notice in your bulletins that you have surveys that look like this. If you would fill those out, these are a chance for those of you that are in the congregation or that attend regularly, or if you just have a good idea, to provide honest feedback for our team. So once finished, the surveys can be dropped off in the blue bucket in the middle of the narthex. If you would put them in there, that would be very appreciated. Also, St. John's is going to be live streaming general conference in the conference room the Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday of general conference. That's this coming Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. Kyle and the folks here have also created a chat room in St. John's Connects for people to receive live updates that week, and we'll include any relevant information that in the church newsletter for February. So we will be live streaming for general conference. I know it is something that you will want to all come to. Bring your popcorn, bring your Cokes, whatever. Bring your tomatoes. But the times on that are Sunday, 1:30 to 6:30, Monday, 8 to 6:30, and Tuesday, 8 to 6:30. We ask your prayers as we attend that general conference. Velvet, would you come and do your announcement?
Good morning, everyone. This evening from 5:30 to 7:30, the Nurture and Care Committee is hosting a family game night. This is open to the young, the old, the young at heart, the university, choir, anybody, everybody, the church family. It's for the entire church family. So we invite you to come, bring some of your favorite games, family games that you have at home or whatever, and bring some light finger snacks to share with everybody. And join us from 5:30 to 7:30 for just a fun evening.
Thank you, Velvet. Hopefully y'all can come to that, as many as can. Frank and Haley have got an announcement as well. Or Frank, or Haley.
Personally, if I'm watching the general conference, I'm having an adult beverage while I do that, just saying. I do need someone younger than Haley to come up and join us.
I'm 27.
She's 27.
Yeah, Avery. Is Avery count?
Does Avery count, okay. I guess. She's younger than you.
How old are you, Avery?
Younger than you.
Oh.
See, if she's younger than 27, then I'm still older than both of them combined. So we are standing side by side. And as Velvet said about game night tonight, it's open to anybody, young, old, in between, whatever. We're starting next week a new college group, and in talking to Haley about that, she and I started talking about some other things, doing some intergenerational activities, or organizing some things, and that's kind of dangerous when she and I start talking. So what we're going to do next week is the kids and the Aldersgate class are going to combine during the Sunday school hour to have Sunday school together. We're calling it Side by Side, and in part, it is to help with Haley's, so she can spend some time with the college group, but it's also, we can learn from each other. I can learn from these young people. I can learn from the younger people, and they can learn from those of my age as well. So nothing official yet. We're calling it Side by Side starting it next week, but we hope to expand that a little bit and maybe do it on a regular basis, and just wanted you to know about that.
I want to say one thing. Who's in the university? Who's excited about next week? We're starting at 9:15. upstairs in room 219. Whoop, whoop. Nope, okay.
We have a wonderful congregation. Let us come now and draw into our own selves and worship God in ways that you're not able to do when you're just out and about. This is a time that is holy, that is contemplative, but that is also a time for community. And so this morning, keeping those things in mind, let us worship God.
Good morning, church. God is revealed not to the person who is self-sufficient or self-righteous, but to the person whose heart is open, whose will is receptive, and whose spirit is humble. In that spirit, may we offer our hearts today in worship. Let us pray. Loving God, we gather in differing states of mind. For some, worship is familiar. For some, it's a new experience. Some are confident of their faith. Some are uncertain, even doubting. Some feel great about their lives, while some are drowning in difficulty. Whatever our state of mind, we are pleased that your Spirit has drawn us here together. And we anticipate your blessing, for you have drawn us together in the spirit of your Son. For this we give thanks. Amen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. We come today to share our joys and to share our concerns. I would lift up the General Conference as we go into that this weekend. For the General Conference and all involved, God, in your mercy and graciousness, hear our prayer. Would you have a joy or a concern that you would share? Prayers for Sally, whose husband died suddenly on Monday. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Cindy. For the family that is the root of St. John's, for this beautiful grandbaby that was born to them, God, in your graciousness, hear our prayer. Yes. Tell me your name again. I'm sorry. Jason. Jason and Lee are celebrating their holy union, their marriage, on the 2nd. God, in your graciousness, hear our prayer. For Kayla Ellis's family, all who love her and those who will be going through things in the coming days and weeks, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For Deborah Bratcher, who is still in the hospital, is she still in ICU? In ICU. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. So sorry, Meredith, I couldn't hear you. For all the birthdays this week, especially those here in the church, which there are a lot of them that have celebrated birthdays this week, God, in your graciousness, hear our prayer. Sarah? For the Hall family, especially tomorrow as he goes into surgery, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. What? I'm sorry. For Paula Potts, who had a severe aneurysm 3 weeks ago, who is recovering in rehab, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dwight? For Dwight's son, who is recovering from skin cancer and surgery for that, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I would also want to remember Robina Tooney, who Jerry died this last week. His services were this past week. And so for Robina and that family, as she continues to recover as well from a broken femur, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jason. for Jason's mother, who is going through financial crisis and other things. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As God hears each of us, there are things maybe that we cannot say out loud that we feel so deeply in our hearts. And so let us go to God in prayer at this time together. Oh, Holy One, you have heard the cries of your people. You hear not only the words that we speak, but you hear the groans, the joys, every feeling that we have in our hearts. Be with those today who we have lifted up out loud, but also be with those who have pain that is unspeakable. We pray that you would be with our church. We pray that you would be with our nation. We pray that you would be with your global community as we navigate and learn how to live with one another. We pray in thanks for this community and ask that you would bless it in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. Will you rise and share the peace of Christ with one another?
Today's gospel lesson is from Luke chapter 6, verses 17 through 26, and can be found on page 64 of the New Testament in your pew Bible. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. He came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea, Jerusalem, and the coast of Tyre and Sidon. They had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases, and those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. And all in the crowd were trying to touch him, for power came out from him and healed all of them. Then he looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven, for that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets." The word of God for the children of God.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning from Emmett and I. So this is good. So today in Sunday school, we read a story, but it was an interactive story. Do you think that we should let them play? Okay. Do you mind playing? All right. So every time I raise this, can you guys please say love? So let's try it.
Love.
Okay. That's good. That's very good. This week, I do know this because I saw this on Facebook, that your mom made an amazing Valentine thing, right? You and her, yes. So I did this as well with my at my school. So we made a Valentine's box today. So we put some Valentines in it. So this will all make sense in a second. So let's start with our story. There once was a man named Paul, and Paul was writing this letter to the city of Corinth. And Paul talks a lot about
love.
And it's a good reminder for us every day. Paul begins by saying that if you do not have
love,
you are like a
clanging cymbal.
And a clanging cymbal is kind of loud and annoying, right? No offense. And Paul says that that is not, okay? He says that it doesn't really matter how wise you are, how smart you are, how much money you have. If you do not have, you really don't have anything. So,
does not
rejoice
in truth. Love rejoices in truth.
Okay, next one.
Controls temper.
Yep.
Love.
Cares about others.
Love.
Love is not rude.
Love.
Love does not boast. Is not jealous.
Love.
is patient and kind.
That's right. So, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, never fails. There is faith, hope, and but the greatest is
love.
So this week, talking to me and Emmett, because it's just us up here, we can show love by how we treat others, by how we act towards one another. And the greatest really is love. Will y'all pray with me, please? Dear God, today we learned about love. We learned that love is patient, kind, caring, not boastful. Love is not mean or keeps record. Remind us to love. Amen.
For 30 years now, California's Sonoma Marin Fair has sponsored this ragingly popular World's Ugliest Dog competition. We're talking Mohawk Chihuahuas, pugs with these drastic underbites, slobber sloppy bulldogs, all parading in all of their glory before fanatical and adoring fairgoers and before a panel of judges. We're talking doting owners with crossed fingers, hoping their extraordinary hound will be the one awarded the grand prize. In 2006, the contest included an online voting segment for the very first time. And this ugly dog title is so coveted that hackers broke into the site that year and deleted 40,000 votes from the contest leader. But even that did not prevent that leader, Pee Wee Martini, from running away with the vote, running away with the title. And by the way, that's Pee-wee there in the first photo in your bulletin. Isn't that a handsome dog? Remember, love. The second photo is Zsa Zsa. Zsa Zsa is the reigning champion. Unfortunately, Zsa Zsa's untimely death was announced a couple of months after she won the title. But her death was announced in USA Today, and it was announced in other papers the world over. Zsa Zsa was a celebrity. I doubt very seriously that my death will make it into the USA Today or other papers the world over. And don't let the title of the contest create a false impression either. The World's Ugliest Dog competition was created not by dog haters, but by dog lovers. It was created to promote advocacy and adoption for all dogs in all their amazing varieties of muttonness. And this adoring, genuine embrace of unconventional, you might even say unapproved beauty, that isn't an isolated phenomenon. It actually has roots in a more universal impulse, that impulse to resist superficial standards, especially standards of conformity of all kinds. That impulse runs deep. That impulse is enduring. That impulse may be even eternal. From our text today, I would say it may even be divine. That impulse is universal, but it's never simple. But what if things like the Sonoma Marin Fair are actually omens of a future when everything is reversed, when ugly will become the new pretty, when out will become the new in, and when disadvantaged will become the new advantage? What if a massive and permanent shift in human ideals and value judgments turned the world upside down, and all of those subliminal partialities that currently favor the beautiful people, what if those are completely inverted, giving birth to a new reality with a new bias for a new kind of perfection that starts dominating everything from the clothing racks in stores to news anchors on television to boardrooms to cultural icons? If you knew this complete inversion was coming, would you not assess the status of things and people who are presently labeled perhaps subpar or ordinary or unspectacular? Would you not assess the status of those things and people and think how fortunate you are, because the future is going to be all yours? In Luke, Jesus comes down from a mountain to stand on a level place with mostly unspectacular followers, and he tells them about the realm that God rules, and that when that realm is fully revealed, it will appear as a completely new creation. The revelation of this reordering of things, he says, is underway, and Jesus is its preeminent sign. And he wants everyone to start getting used to this new order, this new order for community. And he wants everyone to participate in its unveiling and in its establishment. Jesus also levels with the crowd in this way. He acknowledges that there will be some difficulty in assimilating into God's world, because for a while it's going to have to exist as an alternative to the prevailing order. And as such, it will rub up against the norms that sustain the current power structure. It will invert them and subvert them. And while God's realm does not come by pushing the old power brokers out, some are going to find it much harder to adjust than others, simply because God's realm places a premium on absolute equality, perfect justice, plenty for everyone, new norms that will be tougher to integrate for some than for others. So the blessedness that Jesus declares for the poor doesn't mean that God places some premium on a meager existence. Doesn't mean that any more than the woes that he pronounces on the wealthy mean that some devastating judgment awaits the rich. It's just that those who have lived their entire lives in need are much better suited to eagerly and quickly take their places in God's just and righteous kingdom. Others will find the rules of equality and justice and plenty for all a little harder to embrace, and will enter God's new creation more like, Jesus said in another place, more like a camel being shoved through the eye of a needle. Rob Bell says, true spirituality then isn't about escaping this world to some other place where we will be happy forever. A Christian, he says, is someone who anticipates spending forever here in a new heaven that comes to earth. The goal isn't escaping this world, but making this world the kind of place that God comes to. In front of a huge audience of people who would probably be considered the ugliest dogs of that day, Jesus operates with this surgical precision on the hearts of all who would ever want to be his followers. Verse 17 says, he came down with them and stood on a level place. From that level place, it was easy for Jesus to see why the ugliest dog deserved the sash and the crown. That level place is also the best place for Jesus' disciples to stand, to be omens of a future created by a God who loves people in all their amazing varieties of people-ness. And a God who promotes the love of people in all of their amazing varieties of people-ness. That level place is also the best place for Jesus' disciples to declare what Jesus declared. Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you and revile you and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in the heaven that is coming to earth. In the name of Christ, amen.
Please be seated. Let us pray. O Holy One, as we give to others, we are given back so much more. And so may we give of our gifts, of our love, of our time. Bless these gifts in the name of Christ. Amen. I'm in a little bit different spot than you're used to seeing me. But as we approach this general conference, those of you who are not Methodist probably don't have a clue, but our church is going through some real difficulty right now. And it's about people's belief systems. But this song, I just feel like is something we need to carry with us. All we need to do is turn on the news, and we're called to the same thing. And so I will sing the verse. It's printed in your bulletin. And I think maybe all of you at least are familiar with it. We used to sing it at camp. But we sing it today for a very different reason. And so when we get to the part, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, I would invite you to sing with me. Let us worship together. Join together in this last verse.
Oh,
This week I've been intrigued a little by that notion of thinking of Christians instead of being these pious people who, you know, don't smoke or cuss or drink or chew or date the girls who do. And to think of ourselves as omens of a future that God is creating. And I thought as an act of faith that we could think about just some small adjustments, some thing that we can think of that we could do to make that adjustment, to think of ourselves as omens of a future that will be, think of ourselves as signs of something already that will fully blossom in the future. What behavioral change or attitudinal change or adjustment in a relationship could help us move into that kind of a paradigm, to think of ourselves as living omens of an inevitable future that God is creating. So an act of faith this week would be find something like that. That you can do to be already what will be in its fullest sense someday. Watch how that transforms the world around you. Commit to that act of faith. Other things also that are on our hearts as we worship today, we lift to God. As we sing this hymn of faith, will you join your voices in singing?
And now hear and participate in this benediction. The grace of God be yours.
Amen.
The grace of love be yours.
Amen.
The grace of home be yours.
Amen.
The grace of hearth be yours.
Amen.
The grace of faith be yours.
Amen.
The grace of God's life be yours. The grace of the loving Christ be yours. And finally, the grace of the Holy Spirit be yours.